some take a good look around. This is your hometown. This is your hometown. This is your hometown. This is your hometown. My school, there was a lot of fights between the black and white. There was nothing you could do. Two cars at a light on a Saturday night. In the backseat there was a gun. Words are passed, shotgun blast, trouble time.
For being a friend, travel down a road and back again. Your heart is true, you're a pal and a confidant. I'm not ashamed to say, I hope it always will stay this way.
Okay, good morning, church. Great to see everybody. Come on in. Find your seat. Oh, I'm not on yet. Am I on? Can you hear me? Can you hear me? Can anyone hear me out there? One, two. I'm on up here, but I'm not on out there. Hey, hey, hey. Hey, hey, hey. Can you hear me now? No, you can't really hear me. Ian. Ian, am I on? Hey, hey, hey. One, two. One, two. One, two. Can you hear me now? Still not really. Muffly. Check, check. Hey, check. Check, check. Check, check. Hey, one, two. Hey, one, two. Hey, one, two. Hey, one, two. Doesn't sound like the house is on, Ian. Well, pretty soon we're going to start. Hey, one, two. Hey, check. Hey, check. Hey, check. Hey, one. 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 Hey, hey. Hey, hey. Hey, hey. Hey, one. Hey, one. Can you hear that? Is that better? Am I on? Yeah? Okay, great. Now we're ready. Okay, everybody, come on and find a seat. It is great to be together, and we're going to sing an awesome song that we all love. It's called Power, talking about the power of God. But you have to move around. You got to clap your hands. You might even need to bend your knees and do a little bit of dancing if you can. That's good. Everybody ready? Here we go. Here we go. Jesus got the power.
Jesus got the power over death, hell, and the grave. Jesus got the power over death, hell, and the grave. He rose from the dead, just like he said. The temple will be all around power. is amazing. Steady and unchanging. Your love is a mountain firm beneath my feet. Your love is a mystery. How you gently lift me when I am surrounded. Your love carries me. Hallelujah. 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 Your love makes me sing.
You make me sing. How you make me sing, sing, sing. Lord, you make me sing.
Thank you so much for blessing us with this morning, that we can come together and celebrate you and all that you've done or are to us in our lives. God, thank you for providing, for being present in our life throughout the week, throughout the months, throughout this whole year and years before. Father, thank you for your Son and the ways that he had modeled the way of life is pleasing to you, God. That I know that even though we're imperfect people, we can strive to be just like Jesus. And that you're always walking with us to help us along that journey, God. Thank you for everyone here dedicating their time to worship you, to give to you their worship and their heart to you, God. And I pray, Father, as we hear you through the words of your scriptures, God, that we can be moved, that we can grow. And as Advent is among us, Father, I pray that we'd always think about Jesus and what he has accomplished and what he has done in our lives thus far, God. We love you so much. We need you, God, every single day. It's in his name we pray. Amen.
Standing here in your presence, in a grace so renowned.
soul deep, His washing over me. Your face is all I see. You are my everything. Jesus Christ, You are my one desire. Lord, hear my only cry. To know You all my life.
I'm wide awake, drawing close to
everybody. I'm so happy to see everyone, but first I have to say it's time for all the kids to go to their classes. And I'm so glad that God didn't humble me by making me forget that actual thing. That would have been hilarious. So if you could quietly go, it's everybody today, I think junior high, high school, Heritage Project, grade school, everybody gets to go. My name is Tracy Miner, and along with my husband Jay and many others, we serve here in the Orange County Church of Christ. If you're visiting with us today, welcome. I'm so glad that you're here. It's going to be a great day because today we have sort of a double holiday celebration going on. So when you came in, you would have seen that on the screens it said, hey, Happy Thanksgiving, but everything else in this room screams Christmas, right? It's Advent. So I know there are some people out there who are those kind of people. Now, you can admit it. It's okay. If you're the kind of person that gets really irritated when Christmas music is played before Thanksgiving. I know. It's true. I'm not mad at you. I understand.
You got 4 days left.
It is a dilemma. But we are in a it's an overlapping season is what it is, because today we know that this coming Thursday we're going to celebrate Thanksgiving. And Thanksgiving really is all about God and what He has done in our lives. It's a chance for us to be grateful for all He's done. It's actually more than turkey and football. I know we forget that because it takes a long time to fix that turkey. You know, like, and then you got to make sure that the game is right. I don't know. We don't do that in our own house, but I've heard other people do.
Other people do. But you also want to really prepare well for Thanksgiving, because the holidays can be a challenging time. You know, there's a lot of expectations that you may have going into the day, and you're trying to figure out how do we do that. And you might be with family. Is anybody visiting family over the holidays, or have family coming in to visit you? Got a few people. Okay, so we need to especially lay our hands on those people and pray for them. Family can be awesome and wonderful, and also can present some challenges along the way. So we want to really encourage you to prepare well for that day and think ahead about what kind of a day do you want to have and how can it really honor and glorify God. So you kind of have to, you got to make sure that you've got enough time to be able to pray, and you've got enough time to be able to prepare so that you're thinking ahead for what it can be.
Exactly. So we've got that going on this week. But because our particular church here, we have something special that we do, and that is that we meet here in this building 3 times out of the month. And then the fourth week of the month, we meet in what we call Salt Sunday services. And that just means that all over Orange County, we have small groups of disciples coming together to serve the people around them, to gather together to pray, to take communion, and just to actually have a church service on their own. It's amazing. It's probably one of my favorite times. And because that is next Sunday, we are having a special preview Sunday for the Advent season that is coming up, because next Sunday, when it actually officially starts, we'll all be in our Salt Sundays. So we wanted to make sure that you were extra prepared for next Sunday. Oh, good. We have the right slide up there.
I don't know where those came from. Those were extra slides that just hop in. So, we're going to be heading into a season of Advent. Now, how many people, when you were growing up, celebrating Advent was a part of your church tradition or your religious tradition. Did anybody do that when you were growing up? Okay, so we had some people who did that. How many people never celebrated Advent when you were growing up and didn't really know about it? Okay, great. So we want to talk about it a little bit because Advent is not necessarily, not even the word necessarily, Advent is not a biblical holiday. But one of the cool things that has been happening here in Orange County over the last couple of years is we've been delving into the biblical holidays or those festivals that God set in place for his people. And we've talked about how these annual rhythms of celebrating God's festivals teach us spiritual lessons that we can really apply in 2022. So that's why we've been really, you know, we talk about Passover around Easter time and what that means for us. And then we talk about Shavuot, which is like the end gathering. It's the festival where you're celebrating the first fruits, and so you're able to give. And so that's the day that we take up our special missions offering every year. And so we're learning the lessons from that and then applying that to what we're doing. And then in the fall, there's the festival of Sukkot, which is thanking God for the harvest and all he's done. And it is a massive party and a massive festival. And this year we had our big, festival outside in the parking lot, which was great. We had a great time with that. So those are those biblical festivals that go on. And we do want to kind of acknowledge those and just learn whatever God wants us to learn from those. Advent is not, it was not biblically mandated or taught. It's something that developed in the church over centuries. And as with many good ideas that, you know, things happen in the church and we come up with ideas that are really great and pure-hearted, and then sometimes they can become ritualistic or traditional or not so great. And so, you know, I realize that maybe depending on where you come from, you might have that response to something like that. But what we're hoping to do is to be able to talk about it in such a way that we can, you know, see what are these spiritual lessons that we can learn from it, which I think will really be good.
Exactly. So one of the things we thought we'd do is we'd just share our journey with Advent with you. So it's kind of like we're all sitting around in our living room. Actually, for the South, this probably looks normal because we have our practice videos, so kind of like a live practice video, right? Mm-hmm. So you can pretend you're all in our living room.
Right.
Okay, so here's what happened. So what had happened was, you know, we are absolute Christmas lovers. We are not Grinches at all. You know, we put up the tree the day after Thanksgiving, which I thought was extreme until I met the Zaps.
Yeah.
And they put up their Christmas tree the day after Halloween.
Yeah.
I was like, what? Okay. So we love Christmas season. We love everything about it. But as we were raising our family, I started to get that sort of like little depression thing going on. I don't know if anybody else experiences this, but during the season, I would just get kind of depressed that it was so, I don't know, Santa Claus-ish. And I didn't want to be anti-Santa Claus. I'm not the anti-Santa Claus person. But I was like, man, there's just not enough focus on Jesus. And, you know, you watch all the shows, and that's the real meaning of Christmas. But it was always after you do the presents and, you know, all that. So, I just found myself wanting, and then I started, we sort of stumbled upon something. Oh, another thing that happened to me was I started realizing that during the Christmas season, I was just completely giving into debauchery. I mean, like, it was just like a totally gluttonous season. I was overeating. I would overspend, you know, I'd over whatever, watch movies. How do you even say that? I would just be, you know, into Netflix. And it was just so much. I mean, no wonder we need those New Year's resolutions, because by the time you get to the end of December, you know, you got to get that extra 10 pounds that you just put on off. And you got to make all these New Year's resolutions because you just become a blob over the past, you know, month or so. And so I started thinking, and then I was having this experience coming in on Sundays. You know, we happen to be on the stage most Sundays, right? So I get to see the audience in a different way probably than, you know, most people. And always that very first Sunday of the new year was like, oh my goodness. It's like a veil had come across the faces of everyone. Everyone's in this like stupor.
Catatonic state. Yeah.
Exactly. And I was like, I think we got to be doing something wrong. You know, like, this season should be a holy season.
Right.
And let's take the holidays and make them holy days.
Right.
And so at that point, I just decided, I don't know how to do that, but I'm going to try to do something.
And so what we're trying to figure out is that as our culture is going through something, we have to decide, are we going to follow along with what the culture is doing? Or are we as followers of Jesus going to choose to actually act in a way that is counter to our culture if our culture is acting in a way that is not bringing us towards God? And so that's why we're kind of talking about Advent in this season, is we want to help set our minds as Jesus followers so that we can learn how to follow him. So we're not anti-Santa, but we are pro-Jesus in this moment, okay? So, you know, we were thinking this, it was about 12 years ago, and then we kind of came across this movement that was starting to happen in a lot of churches around the country, where other people were feeling the same thing, and they were trying to figure out, how do we approach Christmas differently? And so they had started this thing called Advent Conspiracy.
Love conspiracies.
Right. Many of us love conspiracy theories of some kind. And so here was this way to conspire against the normal way of doing Christmas and actually do it different. And so we actually have this video, this explainer video that shows you kind of what the thought process is. And so there are now, I think, thousands of churches that are all over the country that are trying to implement this thinking at this time of year to help us focus in a different
way.
And
these are evangelical churches.
Yeah.
Not just the traditional, you know, Catholics, of course, have celebrated this forever and some of the other strains from that. But these are just evangelical churches like us.
Right. So this is what Advent Conspiracy is. Okay, so yeah, you clap for that. So that's the idea behind Advent Conspiracy and what a lot of churches started doing. And it was really cool because we introduced this to the church that we were at previously, and it really caught on, and everybody loved it. The families started getting into it. The kids, you know, families together would decide, we're gonna do Christmas different. We're not going to buy the same amount of presents or the same kind of presents. And instead, we're going to take that money that we would have saved or that we would have spent, and we're going to give that to actually help help somebody else. And it was really cool to see how that started. And then we started at every Christmas, we would take up a collection for the money that we would have spent on Christmas that we wanted to do something different with. And then we started using that. We partnered with an organization called Living Water International. We started funding clean drinking water wells in countries all around the world that needed it. And I think over the last 10 years, we helped to drill almost 30 clean drinking water wells. And we sent people to actually do the drilling, and then there's a plaque and it's all this kind of stuff. But it just helped people to really get their minds focused in a different way. And it's that intentionality that really helps us to do that. So there's a couple things, you know, as you saw on the video, there's these four different areas that we kind of want to shift our minds around. And I just wanted to give these to us as suggestions for ways that you could implement and introduce maybe into your family for this season and see what actually works for you.
Exactly. So the first one, of course, is worship fully. And we want to just give you opportunities to be able to experience that, to do that, in whatever way God makes available to you. Something that we were going to make available to you is that we're going to be sending out in your regular weekly newsletters a quiet time series for every day of Advent. So in your inbox each morning, you can find a new quiet time. And all of us will be reading exactly the same quiet time every morning. And the focus of this quiet time series is going to be going slowly, carefully, and beautifully through the story of the birth of Jesus, just kind of soaking in it. Picture yourself getting into a sauna. That's what it's going to be like, just sitting in that story over the next month and just seeing what new things the Holy Spirit can reveal to you through your study of the Nativity story. And that'll be fun because all of us can talk about it, you know, we'll all be on the same page. And then another way is that this Sunday in your Salt Service Sundays, you can make it a special, you know, sort of your first week of Advent service. So I don't want to put that burden. I don't want anybody to feel burdened because sometimes when you're doing something new, you can feel like, am I doing it right? Like everything, where's the rules of Advent? I got to know the rules. I got to make sure I'm doing it. Please don't do that. If you want to get a wreath, it looks like that. You can get a wreath. It's like $6 on Amazon. So it's pretty affordable and easy to do. Basically, every single time you come together, we're just going to light a candle and we're going to talk about a certain theme. So this coming Sunday, the very first Sunday of Advent, is the theme of hope. And so the reason that Jay and I are even doing this together today, which is kind of different, is because we wanted to kind of ignite your holy imagination so that you can sort of look at this season differently. It's less about preaching and it's more about sharing. So when you come together with your groups this Sunday, everybody would come with maybe a scripture about hope or thoughts about how Jesus has given them hope, maybe a song, maybe a poem. Everybody comes together to offer something about hope so that when you get together, not one person is just worried about, oh, I'm supposed to do the lesson this Sunday. You know, does that happen to anyone? I know it does happen sometimes. You might be worried about if you have the lesson to do. This time you don't have to worry about it. It's really just a time to come together, just like in that 1 Corinthian fashion, you know, we read about how one person brings this, one person brings that. And that's what this time is. It's a time of sharing. And every single week that we're together here, we're going to start our service with one of the families lighting our candle. So that's something that we're going to do. Now, this is we're sort of doing a preview, so it's kind of cheating to do it today. But we are going to do that a little bit later on. And so you guys might want to think about, oh, we'll just light a candle. We'll all talk about hope this next Sunday.
Right. So I wanted to ask, is there anyone in here that today, in advance of next week where you're supposed to be feeling hopeful, is there anybody today who is feeling particularly hopeful? Is there anything going on? Just think about that. Are you feeling some hope in your life? Because I'm going to ask for someone. That's awesome. Marco and Michelle, great. Thank you, guys.
Yes.
And actually, let's have Marco and Julio come up together.
Come on.
You guys come on up together?
Since, yes. This is awesome.
And we're going to have Marco and Julio share something that they're hopeful for, and then they're going to light our candle of hope together. All right?
Yes. This is awesome.
So you guys shouldn't sit next to each other at church. See?
Here. You're going to have them share first or what?
Like, yeah, I'm going to have them share first. So come back behind the candles.
Oh, okay.
That's awesome. So is there something that you can share as you think about your life with Jesus? Is there something that you are particularly hopeful about?
Okay. Hopeful about Marco. I'm just kidding. No, today's our 23rd anniversary, my wife and I.
Nice. Congratulations.
Yes. Oh, and so, you know, we think that, we know this, that the only reason we're together, the only reason we made it this far is because of Jesus, and our life is so much more rich because of God, because of the people in this church that have helped us. Marco and I actually went running yesterday, and we were talking about some people in the church that have really helped me personally to make it, and Dale Weber, you know, I don't know if he's here today right now, but he's helped me tremendously with our marriage, with our kids throughout the years, and just been there as an anchor and a rock, and many other people have. So that, I think that's the hope I feel, is that God has given us that hope to be able to be married 23 years, 23 more. You up for it? You up for the journey?
That's awesome. All right,
Mark. You know, as Julie and I were talking yesterday on our run, one of the things I was thinking about was just how faithful God has been just with his provisions. I was telling him that I could think 20, 30, 40 things that God has just come through, if not at the last minute, just where you go, that was God. God provided, and where I felt flat, stuck, perplexed, stressed out of my mind, whatever. And then God just provided, not always with a happy story, but he provided and met the need to get through that next obstacle. And so I feel very hopeful for our family. We've had lots of challenges and lots of twists and turns, and just when you think you hit a twist, then there's another turn. And yet God is giving incremental growth with all of my kids, and so I'm really grateful for that and feel very hopeful that though it's not as fast as I would like, I'm grateful that God just keeps providing, and my kids love us and love each other and love God, and you know, all very, very amazing things and supernatural when you think about it. So,
awesome. Amen.
That's great. Thank you. All right. So,
just don't do the pink one. Do one of the purple ones.
Yeah, do that
ones.
One right there.
No,
you don't.
It's not a wedding, bro.
Yeah. let's not do
one
that.
One of you go.
It's his 23rd anniversary. He can light it. Great. That's awesome.
Happy anniversary, Natalie.
There it is. The candle of hope is lit. Awesome. Thank you, guys.
Thank you, guys.
Appreciate that.
Brave souls.
Never boring with those two in your small group, let me tell you. Did it go out? Julio, you got to come back.
It would be a bad omen. We can't let that happen.
No, we can't let that happen for sure.
I heard that, yeah.
Okay.
Okay, they are not trick candles.
There we go.
Now, usually we will start our services for Advent with one of our families lighting the candle. Next week, we already have our family picked out.
Yeah, for
but
two
you have
weeks.
To come back.
For
oh,
two
and
weeks.
No, not for next week,
right.
For the 2 weeks. You have to come back to find out who it is.
Next week, we will be. It's Salt Sunday, so you'll be in your small groups. And if you wanted to do this and light the candle of hope, then you could do that in your group as well. Don't have to. If it feels weird, don't worry about it. But it's a cool moment just to be able to kind of reflect on what God does, that his hope is continually available to us. And we're reflecting on the hope that Jesus brings. I'll talk about that a little bit more in a minute. But the two of the other things with Advent Conspiracy is the thought that we spend less so that we can give more. I talked about that and how we did that in our previous church. But what I love is that today is our day. It's the International Day of Giving. And so for Hope Worldwide, as a church, we are dedicating ourselves to support this organization. And Hope Worldwide does so many amazing things. And in particular, you know, we have been partnering with them to help support the Tijuana Center of Hope. And Martin Chirez has done done an amazing job kind of coordinating that and getting that going, and we're providing dental care to hundreds of children in that area and their families, and even more things are now starting to take place. We're making a huge difference in that community, and that is in large part due to, you know, the support of the Orange County Church. But today is our day to support the Hope Worldwide organization as a whole, and so to, in order for them to continue to do what they do and leveraging the money that we give them, we are supporting them. So a little bit later today, we're going to take up that offering. I know many of you have already given online, so thank you for doing that, and we want to ask you, if you haven't already, to just pray about that and then see what God puts on your heart to be able to give to support Hope Worldwide. And you might even think ahead, like I know that, you know, we're talking about this today, but you might think ahead for your Christmas season, could we alter our Christmas budget so that we could give some of that money to Hope? And is that something that your family might feel led to do? So these are things that you can think about and process.
Yeah, and the last thing that it talks about is but loving all. And, you know, this, sometimes you can get, it's kind of crazy if you think about what kind of Satan has done with this time. It seems it's counterintuitive, but sometimes we're too busy for people during this season. I mean, real people. I mean, we get our cards done. We got to send those out. You know what I'm saying? But sometimes we're so busy, we don't have enough time to love people. And so we're hoping, now I don't know if this is too, you know, pie in the sky. I'm always a little bit too, you know, optimistic about things sometimes. Sometimes to the point of being unrealistic. But I'm hoping that we can intentionally take time, slow ourselves down to be able to love the people that we encounter during this time, mm-hmm. our neighbors. So in kind of, instead of pulling back from our, I don't know, evangelistic endeavors, if that word rings for you, instead changing that to, I'm going to have more time to reach out to my neighbors. I want to make sure that I'm spreading love to the people that I come into contact with, because during this time, people are hurting.
Right.
You know, I mean, here I was, I had everything. As far as the world is concerned, I feel like I have a wonderful family. I'm not even remotely close to the poverty line. I've got a job with purpose in my life. I mean, I feel like I almost had everything. And still, I would experience a sort of melancholy during the season. Mm-hmm. So now you think about people who are really on the rocks during the season, mm-hmm. and why the suicide rate does raise during this time. Because people are feeling a lot. So we have to be giving a lot. And God gives to us so we can give back. So one of the ways that we're going to be just reminding ourselves about loving one another is that probably on the way in you saw there was a table set up there to buy a poinsettia. And that the idea behind that is that we wanted to see if we could all come together to make this auditorium just beautiful, overflowing with love, with poinsettias. And so we wanted to give everybody the opportunity to sort of purchase a poinsettia in memorial of someone. Is that, I'm saying that right then? So in honor is kind of like someone who's alive, okay. But when you're memorializing someone, so we wanted to give you the opportunity to be able to purchase a poinsettia to remember a loved one that you might have lost over these past few years. You know, I'm doing this, this sort of spiritual growth program. And a part of that has been to, as often is a part of these programs, to kind of chronicleize your life. You know, go back and look at your life and you kind of make this timeline. And I realized something as I was going through it that I hadn't quite allowed myself to feel. And that was that in 2016, Jay's dad passed away. And that was hard. And then in 2018, my dad passed away. And then in 2019, my mom passed away. And soon after that, we moved to Orange County. You know, you try to grieve along the way. You try to heal along the way, but sometimes you just can't. Because life is demanding. And so when Joanne had brought this idea up to me, I thought, I want to get three poinsettias to remember those people that I haven't gotten to, you know, I just want to remember them during this time. And this whole auditorium could be just filled with memories and honor of all the people that we're so close to. And it's a way for us to love all.
Yep. I also want to encourage you to take time, even today, if you can, and look at your calendar from now through the end of the year and put some special times in your calendar where you want to have someone into your home just to love them. And you know, that you go ahead and put that in now. If you wait till December 15th or 17th and think, oh, can we have somebody over?
Now,
you're always going to say no, because it just gets too busy and you're going to feel overwhelmed. But if you're planning out 5 weeks ahead of time or 4 weeks ahead of time, that's much easier for you to go, this is important to us to spend time with these people that we love, and so we want to have that. So we like to do that. We like to put on our calendar, there's time, we want to get with the people that we really miss and love and don't get to see a lot, and we also want to have time to spend time with people that we're developing a new relationship with and someone we're growing with. So I want to encourage you to do that. And so as we head into this season, I think these are things for us to think about, that we want to worship God with all of our heart, worship Him fully. We want to spend less so that we're not getting caught up in the materialism of our culture. We want to give more because that's what Jesus did. He gave Himself. He was always giving. And we want to love as many people as we can, as much as we can, with the love of God, because that's who God is He is full of love. So I wanted to invite you into that, into thinking about, you know, Advent in that way. And, you know, that's a way for us as a church to kind of, you know, take some steps towards changing the way that we do Christmas, which can kind of be fun. But I wanted to talk about then this idea that is behind Advent, and the word even comes from this idea of waiting, that we are waiting for something. So, you know, if we go back the last few months here, we've been talking about, we were in Daniel all summer, and Daniel is in the part of the story where the people have been taken into captivity into Babylon. And then after that, they were able to come back. And so Ezra and Nehemiah led them back into Jerusalem so that they could start rebuilding the city and rebuilding the temple and rebuilding the wall around Jerusalem. And so we have those stories then, and we've got the prophets of Zechariah and Malachi that were prophesying during that time. And then all of a sudden, the prophetic record stops. And then there is this period of 400 years until the book of Matthew starts and the Gospels start. And in that time, what was happening was that they were waiting. They were waiting for the Messiah to come. And it was a time where they were looking forward to what Jesus was going to do, or what the Messiah was going to be able to bring. And also in that time, they were definitely growing and they were learning. Because there was a remnant of people that came back from Babylon and they were like, we can never do this again. We can never get sent into exile again. We have to get serious about our relationship with God. And so during this time is when they started to develop the synagogue system, because now the Jews were scattered. They were everywhere. The temple was no longer there. How do we have our worship? And that's when the synagogue system developed. So every week they could come together and read the Torah together and have a spiritual community. And then that's when they started developing their education system for their kids, where they were like, we have to get this word in our hearts so that we never forget it. Like, remember we talked about Josiah, that they found the book of the law, meaning that somewhere along the line they had lost it. And they were like, we can never lose this again. So what we're going to do now is we're going to memorize it. And so all the children growing up memorized Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, and Deuteronomy. They had it in their heart. They knew it by heart. And then many of those kids would go on and they memorized the rest of the Old Testament. Memorized it.
Not the names of the books. Let's
no.
be clear.
The names of the books. The entire thing. They would memorize it so that when they were having conversations, they could remember it. Just like many of us recall the things that happened. You know, Luke, I am your father. We know what that comes from, right? And as soon as I say that, you're reminded of the whole story of Star Wars and what goes on with that. And if somebody says, my precious, then we know immediately that we're going to Lord of the Rings, right? And we know the story because you say one line and we're reminded of the story. And that's what Jesus, the guys that he was training to be his apostles, they grew up memorizing this stuff. So you would say one line to them and they would go, oh yeah, that reminds me of the story. And you could just mention a line from Zechariah or Malachi or Isaiah and they would go, oh yeah, I know what he's talking about. I know the part of the story he's talking about, because it became deep in their culture. So during this 400 years, they were learning and they were waiting. And they were developing their culture, and they were waiting. And then they were trying to figure out, how do we do this better? And they were waiting. They were waiting for the Messiah to come. Because as they studied the scriptures, they could see in there that the Messiah is coming and he is going to change our life. And they were desperate for him to restore the kingdom. They wanted it to be restored. And so they were looking forward to that. And so it was this sense of waiting where you're realizing God has done great things for us. And I know many of them felt like he brought us back from captivity. We were not left in Babylon. He brought us back. He paved the way for us to have this relationship with him. So there is a gratitude for what God has done. And we're waiting for what is to come. That is the season of Advent. And that's what we do now, is that we experience and express our gratitude for the fact that Jesus came, that he came to earth, that he was born as an infant, that he was raised then, that he lived this life to point us to God, that he sacrificed himself for our sin. And now we're grateful for that, and we have our forgiveness and salvation, right? You should be grateful for that. You should wake up in the morning and go, God, I cannot believe that you have forgiven me. And if you don't wake up like that, then that's something that I want to urge you to do. You need to bring yourself back to that moment. For many of you, if you were a follower of Jesus, you remember that. You remember that baptism moment where you were like, Jesus is Lord. I will follow him and I will do anything because he died on the cross for me. And if he did that for me, I will go anywhere and do anything for him. Do you remember that? Do you remember that? Do you remember that moment? This should be what you're feeling when you're reflecting on the fact that you have been forgiven. And so we have this moment of incredible grace that God has given us, and we are waiting for Jesus to come back. So we're reflecting on the fact that he came, and we're looking forward to the fact that he's coming back. I've been listening a lot lately to Phil Wickham has an album out. He released an album a couple years ago called Hymn of Heaven. Isn't that it? Is it Hymn of Heaven? It's called Hymn of Heaven. And all the songs on it are just pointing to heaven and the way just to think that heaven is coming. And I'm telling you, it is just changing my worship life. It's awesome. The regular album is like, it's okay, yeah, it's cool. But he did an acoustic version where he did all the songs in an acoustic way. So listen to the acoustic version. If you're into that kind of thing, look up Phil Wickham, Hymn of Heaven, acoustic. And listen to that. It will change your life. All jokes aside, I think it will help your experience of Advent because it helps put your eyes up on heaven and what is to come. So, you know, as they were waiting and these different groups were forming and different things were happening, then we fast forward to Zechariah and Elizabeth. Right. You want to talk about that?
Yeah, so, you know, here we have the first miraculous sighting, and Gabriel appears to Zechariah, right? And I don't want to go too far into it, but the last time that we saw Gabriel in the Bible was when? Do you remember? It was in Daniel. So Gabriel appears to Daniel after he has fought with, I don't know, the prince of Persia or something like that, something crazy, where he had to call down the archangel Michael to help him out so that he could make it through all the spiritual forces of evil in the heavenly realms to be able to talk to Daniel while he was, having these great visions. Okay, so that's the last time we saw the angel Gabriel. Now he appears again, and who does he appear to but this very elderly man, telling him that his wife, who's also very elderly and far past childbearing age, is going to have a baby, and they should call him John. And John is going to prepare the way for the Messiah. So you'll have to come back for, you know, the quiet times of that. But this is Elizabeth, his wife. You know, she gets the news. She's pregnant. She's literally pregnant at whatever age. At the youngest, she was in her 60s. So some of my 60-year-old sisters, think about it, okay? Just saying. All right, so Rebecca, Elizabeth. And then Mary gets a second sighting of the angel Gabriel. And, you know, it's interesting because there's no mention in these two sightings of any spiritual battle. There's not like a big, you know, archangel coming down to fight the way. You think about that. So in Daniel's time, it had to be this huge, epic thing. Now, here we have the Savior of the world. And it seems like it's slipping right by Satan's radar. Because he's looking for the powerful. He's working with the powerful, not the 15-year-old peasant girl who no one cares about anyway, a except for God.
Right.
Is that, I mean, it just, this, I love this painting because these are the only two women on the planet who know for a fact that God is working a miracle.
Right.
Yeah. In fact, everybody else is very suspicious.
Yeah.
Of this 15-year-old virgin. Uh-huh. Like, how could she be a virgin? But they know that they know that they know that God worked that miracle. So can you imagine that conversation? So they meet up, and the Holy Spirit that is inside of John, inside the womb, it says, he's filled with the Holy Spirit. It, like, overflows into Elizabeth, and she's like, Mary! I mean, he leaps in her womb, and she starts prophesying. She starts speaking the words of the Holy Spirit straight to Mary. And then it's almost like the Holy Spirit spills out of her into Mary. And she writes, she says, the most beautiful original Advent song is what it is. It's the first Christmas carol.
Yeah. Yeah.
She speaks that's been called the Magnificat. Right? That's the nickname that the Catholic Church gave it, because at the beginning of it, she says, my soul magnifies the Lord. My soul, what does a magnifying glass do but make something look bigger?
Right.
She's like, my soul is going to make God seen. Magnifying glasses, they make you be able to see all the fine print on those little bottles, you know? What, you know the medicine bottles? I mean, I have probably like 7 pairs of magnifying glasses in my house, just so you know. Plus, I have the one that you pick up like Sherlock Holmes, you know, to look through in case I got some medicine I need to see the fine print on. When you get that magnifying glass, you can see every wrinkle. You know, you also use that for your makeup too, right, ladies? Like, yeah, you got to use that magnifying side, right? So you can see every little blemish, every little wrinkle. Magnifying glasses help you to see. And she was saying, my soul is making God look good.
Right.
Everybody's going to be able to see every laugh line, every gentle nuance of God's face because of what he's doing for me. My soul magnifies the Lord, and my spirit rejoices in God my Savior, for he has looked with favor on the lowly state of his servant. Surely from now on all generations will call me blessed. If she only knew.
Right.
Think about that, guys. Mm-hmm. I mean, it's gotten to the point where she's almost deified, right? Mm-hmm. She's prophesying here. Surely from now on, all generations will call me blessed, for the Mighty One has done great things for me, and holy is his name. Mm. I mean, can you imagine you're sitting there pregnant and you know? Well, this was miraculous. What it would do to your insides. It's amazing.
Yeah.
And then she goes on and she said, indeed, his mercy is for those who fear him from generation to generation. He has shown strength with his arm, and he has scattered the proud in the imagination of their hearts. I love the way that is said. He has scattered the proud in the imagination of their hearts. Many of us can be proud at times. Anybody else struggle with pride? I struggle with pride, right? But oftentimes, it's not reality. It's just the imagination of my heart where I'm so awesome, you know. And so, but God here is scattering the proud in the imagination of their hearts. He's actually saying, no, this is not the way that you think you are. It's actually not that way. Because God is a God who brings dead things to life. He takes things that are not and calls them as if they were. God changes things, takes the lowly and makes them lifted up. It's beautiful. Then he goes, she goes on, says, he has brought down the powerful from their thrones and lifted up the lowly. Think about that statement. He has brought down the powerful from their thrones and lifted up the lowly. She's remembering the stories in the Old Testament where God would bring down the powerful from their thrones and unseat kings. He has filled the hungry with good things and sent the rich away empty. So do you see the contrast here in the things that she's talking about? Then she goes on, he has come to the aid of his child Israel in remembrance of his mercy, according to the promise he made to our ancestors, to Abraham and to his descendants forever. I love this. It's such a beautiful prayer. But you know what is actually powerful about this prayer is that she is saying that God is going to take these rich and powerful kings and dethrone them and do something that they would never actually even imagine. And these words are actually subversive. These words are dangerous. So much so that three times in the last 100 years, three separate governments of countries have outlawed the reciting of this passage of Scripture. As recently as 1980, in the 80s, there were governments. It was one
Argentina and
Argentina,
Guatemala.
Yeah, and then the UK and India. Because as people started quoting this, what they were saying is they realized, no, God is saying that these structures that get put in place by our society that oppress people, this is not who God is. This is not God's heart to oppress people. God's heart is to bring down the powerful, to send the rich away hungry, but to take care of those who are in need. And so as people would start to, they would put these things on posters and put them up, and they would recite them in their churches, it became outlawed. This is the power of Scripture. This is the power of these ideas of who God is and what He does. And this is what Mary knew, is it's going to be very different, because the Messiah is coming to me, a 15-year-old peasant girl, not in the way that everybody else thinks. And God is all about these marvelous and wondrous reversals, where we think life is going to be a certain way, and God goes, no, it's actually different than that. And we see this in Jesus' teaching all through that. I mean, you think about the Sermon on the Mount. You have heard it said this, but I tell you it's actually this way. God takes the things that appear to be really big, and He goes, no, it's actually not going to be that way. I'm going to do it differently. You know, He's always talking about how you might think that you're rich now, you've got this stuff right now, but it's really the condition of your heart that is going to be important when we get to heaven. So God has this idea of wondrous reversals. He's always changing things and turning things around, and it's not empire, but it's love. It's not empire, the kingdoms of the world, but it's peace, it's shalom. And that's what God does. Now, if we fast forward a little bit, a few more months, and Mary has now, she's almost ready to give birth, and it's time for them. They have to go take up, the Romans have said, you got to go back to the city of your birth and register with the census. And so she has to go to, where does she go? Does everybody know? Bethlehem. Okay, so they go from Nazareth to Bethlehem, and when they get to Bethlehem, they're then, you know, there's no room in the inn, and they're out there in the manger, and she's giving birth. But do you know what you can see from Bethlehem? You can see the Herodium. Does anybody know what the Herodium is? The Herodium is this huge, massive palace that Herod built. It's this amazing, huge palatial complex that was built up on top of this hill. And he built it because he wanted to outdo Solomon. Solomon had built this huge palace, and Herod was like, I'm going to go bigger than Solomon. I'm going to be better than Solomon. I'm going to have a house for myself that's bigger than what Solomon's was. And so he built this huge, massive, massive palace up on top of this hill. And you could see it for miles around. This is actually the hill where it was. They're excavating it now. And so it's up on this hill. I mean, can you imagine? Just for miles around, you could see this from all over. And from Bethlehem, you have a clear view of the Herodium. So here's Mary. Can you imagine her giving birth to Jesus, looking up at this Herodium, at this palace that is the symbol of wealth and opulence and empire and oppression? And she's like, he has no idea what's about to happen. The Messiah is now being born. In the shadow of the kings of the world, the King of Kings came into reality.
I was just thinking about how they're having to excavate that, because, of course, it toppled. But we are all sitting here 2,000 years later.
Right.
We are the building. We are the church. We've lasted for 2,000 years.
Right.
That was down in the next 100 years.
Right.
It's so amazing. You know, you really do have to look past what you can see to what you can't. You know, sometimes it's so difficult because you come to church or you go to a big experience and you're like, I feel so close to God. God is amazing. I know he's all that matters. Jesus is coming back. Oh my goodness, we have to live for God. I have to help the world. You know, you can get that part of your going, and then the next day you go to your job at Target. And then you're like, well, I guess I'll do it tomorrow. You know what I mean? Like, it can bring you down. You know, when you're just living the regular life, you go home and you got a leak in your roof, and then you got to move everything out, and then you got to get the people in there, and you know, life happens. We have to keep our mindset on what we can't see. That's what I love about this season, is every day getting up and thinking, it's what you can't see, Tracy. It's what you can't see. That's what's going to be here in 2,000 more years.
Right.
We got to think with the end in mind and live with the end in mind.
So my soul magnifies the Lord. During this season, over these next 4 weeks, can you allow your soul to make God seen? Can you live your life in such a way that God becomes more readily observable by the people in your life? Can you make choices that are going to help people change and follow him more? Are the things that you do with your time and with your heart and with your money, do those things actually magnify how awesome Jesus is? And now is the time that you get to choose that. You know, I many times have gotten to the end of a holiday season and go, oh, I wish I would have done this. Oh, I wish I would have approached this differently. Now is the time for us to prepare to do that and think that way now. So what we're going to do now is we're going to really usher in this season by sharing a communion meal together. And we're going to share this sacred moment of thinking like, man, Jesus is awesome. He sacrificed himself for me. He gave his life. He gave his body. It was broken. He gave his blood. It was shed. And I'm going to remember that now. And now I'm going to fast forward, like bring this forward into my life so that I can honor him in that way. And I'm going to allow my soul to magnify who he is and how awesome he is. You want to pray for us?
Yes, I'd be glad to. So you guys have your little communion that you got when you came in, right? If you want, you can go ahead and open it up because it goes crackle, crackle, pop. And sometimes it can be distracting. So you can open it up now if you'd like. All right, let me pray for us. Father God, we are so impressed with you. My soul is overwhelmed with how amazing you are. When I see the genius of your plan and the upside down nature of everything that you are, and the fact that you really do love the humble. You love humility. You love things to be upside down from what the world thinks that they are. We're in awe of your genius, God. And we thank you that we have this time to be able to enter into celebrating the birth of Jesus Christ. And it's gotten crazy through the years, and it's become a Santa Claus thing, and then we don't even really know, was he really born in December and all of that, God. We don't know the truth about that. But we do know the truth about what Jesus has done in our lives. And I'm just so grateful to have this time to focus on it. So God, we just come to you right now because we have this chance to drink and eat the body of Jesus, to have this tangible way of entering into his life, his birth, his death, his resurrection. It's everything to us, God. It's everything. And I pray that you would help us during this time to get a clearer picture of you and who you are. God, we feel messed up a lot. We feel inadequate, lonely, insignificant. But we know that's not how you see us. And that mercy is beyond my imagination. Thank you for not treating us as our sins deserve. Thank you for not treating us like we are peasants, even though that's what we are. that you lift us up. You let us walk with you. You're not embarrassed by us. You're not ashamed of us. God, we just decide right now to let you decide who we are. Even over how we feel about ourselves. Thank you for this time to experience your forgiveness and grace. In Jesus' name, amen.
All that I have is a hallelujah. yet shy on me, lift up your soul. Cause you've got a lion inside of your lungs. Get up and praise the Lord. So come on, my soul. Don't you get shy on me, lift up your soul. Cause you've got a lion inside of your lungs. Get up and praise the Lord. Oh, come on, my soul. Oh, don't you get shy on me, lift up your soul. Cause you've got a lion inside of your lungs. Get up and praise the Lord. Oh, praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord.
Everybody sing with me.
Quick announcement that was just brought to my attention. Can I have Brian Ming stand up, please? Brian will be baptized from the Korean ministry after service, so he will be your brother in Christ very shortly. All right, so from that, you got to listen to me talk for 2 minutes, so I apologize. So right now, we are going to try to do two things at the same time, kind of like paying attention at service and looking up fantasy football scores.
No,
oh, wait,
no.
We're not supposed to do that, so forget I said that. We are at the portion of the service where we take up our offering. Today is a special service that's been indicated that we'll be taking up two different collections at the same time. We will be taking up our weekly offering, and we will also be taking up our annual Hope Day of Giving offering. I know some of us think we do a better job of multitasking than others, so I've got some logistics that we need to pay attention to for the next 60 seconds, right? So regarding the Hope Annual Day of Giving, just a reminder that the goal is for every member to give $1 per week, so do the math, that's $52. Per member, that's the hope, that's the goal, right? Electronically, and I think that most of us are doing this electronically, so thank you for that. Electronically, you can give that way. You can give either through the OC Church of Christ app, or you can give online. Just a reminder that to select the proper drop down as you give. So if you want to give to the offering, click the offering. If you want to click for the day of giving, or hope for hope, click hope. If you want to give analog by check, make your checks payable to LAICC. Please put in the earmark, I want this to go to weekly, or I want this to go to Hope. Make sense? Make sense. I'm going to say it one more time because we have two offerings, and I know I saw at least one person on a device. I don't trust that they were listening to me as I said what I said, right? For those who want to give electronically, OC Church app, online, select the right drop-down menu. For those who want to give via check, LAICC, put in the earmark, hope, or weekly offering. All right, that's all the logistics. Let's read a scripture, right? So, it's big because my eyes are terrible. 1 Thessalonians 1, verse 3, it says, "We remember before our God and Father your work produced by faith, your labor prompted by love, and your endurance inspired by hope in our Lord Jesus Christ." 1 Thessalonians 1, verse 3. So as we've been talking today, the holidays are right around the corner, and I realize giving can be a challenge until we remember why we have so many reasons to give. We give because God believes in us. We give because Jesus loves us. We can give a lot of different things over this holiday season, right? Video games, clothes, books, all that stuff, right? But right now we have the opportunity to give something really precious, right? Something better than socks and underwear. Your something means everything to people who are looking for the gift of hope. Let's pray. Father God, thank you so much for this opportunity to be able to give. Thank you for giving to us so much, for taking care of us, providing us, encouraging us, inspiring us through our time here today. Please use these offerings in a great way to provide hope to those who need, and to provide within the needs of this church family as well. We love you. We thank you. It's your son's name we pray all these things. Amen. So as the baskets are being passed, we're going to go ahead and stand, and we'll be singing a song.
Let the King of my heart be the mountain where I run, the fountain I drink from. Let the King of my heart be the shadow where I hide, the answer for my life. Oh, He is my song, 'cause you are good, good. Oh, you are good, good. Oh, and let the King.
Sing it like you mean it. Come on.
Never gonna
All right, my friends, have a wonderful Thanksgiving, an incredible service next week, and we'll see you back here in 2 more weeks.